Newton's Board of Aldermen leadership dilemma, Mayor Mann collects aid for California earthquake victims,
Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday is observed in Newton, and Bosnian citizens visit Newton City Hall.
You're watching NewTV 13, Newton's public, educational, and governmental cable access channel. Up next, Newton News, NewTV 13's news magazine program. This is Newton News.
Good evening, everyone. I'm John Frassica, along with Jennifer Knight. Welcome to this very first edition of NewTV 13's Newton News. Our mission on this program is to inform you about what goes on in the city of Newton. We will take you to news, entertainment, sports, and other community events. We will also set aside time to talk in depth with panelists about a variety of subjects pertaining to our city and you. So be sure to join us live, that's every second and fourth Monday night of each month at 6 o'clock. Our top story tonight, the 9-week power struggle continues in the Board of Aldermen. The board has had no leadership since early December, and last week things got even worse. After a grueling 5-hour meeting last Tuesday night, Alderman Richard McGrath, who was involved in a battle for the board's presidency with Ward 7 Alderman Lyle Baker, stepped aside in favor of Ward 2 Alderman Thomas Concannon. McGrath and Baker have both obtained the same number of votes in numerous ballots since the fiasco began last year. Shortly after McGrath stepped aside, Baker did as well because of a prior agreement with McGrath. This has only added more frustration to the other aldermen since Baker's supporters and McGrath backers have disagreed on any compromise candidates. The Board of Aldermen hope to elect a new president by tonight in a special session, and you can see it here live on NewTV 13, and that's at 7:45.
The city of Newton lends a helping hand to the victims of the California earthquake. Northern Los Angeles was devastated by the quake last week. You might recall thousands were left without water or power, many more without homes. For this reason, Mayor Mann has decided to serve as a middleman for donations. You can send your checks made payable to any of the locations, any of the organizations you see on your screen, AmeriCare's LA Earthquake Relief, American Red Cross, or the Salvation Army. Send your checks to the mayor's office, Newton City Hall, 1000 Commonwealth Avenue, Newton, Mass., 02159.
The dream of Martin Luther King Jr. is alive in the city of Newton. Hundreds of people came out to celebrate Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday at the Second Church in Newton last week. Kids and their folks sang along with the All Newton Elementary School chorus and listened to several speeches. We are told that similar events are planned for next year.
Sarajevo citizens visit Mayor Mann to appeal for understanding of their plight. The editor-in-chief of Sarajevo's last surviving newspaper spoke with Mayor Ted Mann last week to reestablish the ties made last spring. Discussion centered on a petition sent to President Clinton pledging aid and support for Bosnian citizens. The visit was sponsored by the local chapters of American Jewish Congress and the American Jewish Committee.
Let's take a look at now tonight's feature story, and it's on our friends at the Newton Police Department. And a good group they are indeed. We're going to check with that feature story in just a moment, so stay with us. We want to remind you that coming up in our special discussion segment will be the chief of the Newton Police Department. His name, Frank Gorgone. He will talk with us about some of the things that are happening at the Newton Police Department.
Basically, you have to know the areas that the cars are assigned to.
Neil Atkins, a Newton resident with 20 years on the force, ensures calls are effectively handled, enabling patrolmen to respond within 5 to 7 minutes of a call.
But you have to kind of know what the area would be. When we go to the computerized system, the computer will tell you. What you have to know now is when a car is tied up and who to send and things like that. You won't have to know that with the new system. The computers will know. Also, we're going to go to an E911 system. What that means is every time that somebody calls on 911, it will automatically punch up the name and address of the person that's calling.
The Newton Police Department will shortly be using new combined police and fire dispatch computers, which will display caller names and addresses, and also target the appropriate patrolmen to respond to the calls. 24 hours a day, there are 11 officers and cruisers patrolling the city's 11 police divisions. In addition, there are two cruisers covering shift changes, two traffic cars, officers on foot patrolling city squares, and detectives in unmarked cars. What is it like to be a police officer in Newton? Officer Frank Eldridge has been a patrolman for 3 years.
I don't think that most people understand exactly what a police officer does and what a police officer's job involves and how dangerous it can be. Most people appreciate you when they need you, and otherwise they consider you a nuisance.
Right, one day you might have an armed robbery, next day you might have a stabbing, next day you might have another serious call, and then after that you might not have anything for a while, and then the same thing happens again, they come in a rash. Sometimes you go all day without a call like that. Sometimes you can go a week, a month without a serious call like that. I think it's every police officer's job to do community policing. Basically what you do is you get to know the people within your division, and by you getting to know the people within your division, they get to know you too, and they're more comfortable with reporting crimes, being witnesses in court cases, because they know that you're there and that you really care.
Officer Tom Geegan has spent 7 out of his 10 years on the force as a patrolman in his childhood neighborhood of Auburndale.
Sometimes the knowledge of, you know, knowing somebody, it helps to diffuse a situation that otherwise could become somewhat hostile or difficult. I'm just cruising around, checking the businesses, seeing if everything looks all right.
When you're walking a foot beat, you know, you're trying to stay out where people can see you, and you're watching the traffic flow to make sure there's no problems, see if there's any motor vehicle violations that might be going by. Basically checking with the business people, see how they're doing, if they've had any problems, like I said, then, you know, it's visibility, high visibility. Right? More visible, the more likely you are to deter crime or potential crime anyways.
Most of the job is, you know, you're out there patrolling, answering calls for service. Newton's basically a service-oriented department. People calling for ambulance runs when somebody gets hurt or they need assistance. I mean, basically we go to service calls, but, you know, the threat of the dangerous calls are always there.
The police department's Community Services Bureau, housing the new video unit and the drug awareness, resistance education, bicycle safety, and crosswalk programs, exemplifies grassroots involvement with community needs. DARE officer George Claflin informs Newton fifth graders about issues related to drug use.
I have seen a real change in the city of Newton as far as the kids are concerned, and the relationship between the kids and the police. As I said, when I was growing up, the only real contact you had with police was when someone did something wrong, committed a crime. And now you see a lot more interaction between the police and the community. Community policing is what they refer to it as, but you see a lot more of that, and that's only going to benefit the community.
Lieutenant Bob McDonald, Commander of Community Services.
If somebody has a problem, they can contact the Community Service Bureau, and we will do a follow-up investigation on whatever it may be. Or if there are some services that somebody wants provided, they would call us, and we would find out if we could provide that service. So that's really what a goal of a Community Service Bureau is to make the community feel comfortable that they can talk to the police, they can call the police if they have a question on something, or if they have something that they want information about, they can call the Community Service Bureau.
Last year, for the first time in 5 years, the Newton Police Department hired 4 new officers. 10 new officers were hired this month and will shortly begin work based in a newly renovated headquarters building. In difficult financial times, the Newton Police Department evidently has a lot to look forward to.
We're back again on Newton News, and joining us in the studio is the police chief of the city of Newton, Frank Gorgone. Good afternoon, sir. Good evening, I should say, and welcome to NewTV 13. A lot of things going on that we want to talk about, and a great video piece put together by your department. But I think everybody has this on their mind, and we talked about this last Friday, too, about renovations of the new headquarters. How is it going? Explain it to the audience.
Well, right now, they have just completed the demolition portion of it. As you know, we've been out of the old station since July. Mm-hmm. They actually started the remodeling in September. We have been in temporary quarters at the old Davis School, at Chestnut Street, which is our annex building, and also behind the police station as a portion of the garage was remodeled for our Special Service Bureau. We're happy with what's going on so far. Our understanding is that they're pretty much on target. They have completed the demolition of the building, which means it's been completely gutted. The remodeling is not involving any increase of on the outside of the building. The footprint of the building is going to remain the same, but they're going to be doing a lot of work inside, extensive work inside, relocating a lot of the areas, especially the cell area, which was a big concern of ours prior to the project starting.
Chief, you're going to be done with the renovations sometime soon, and I understand the police and fire departments have combined their dispatch systems.
Yes.
How is this going to work?
Will be all calls coming in for either the police or the fire will be handled through the dispatch center, the combined dispatch center, police fire. It was great. In fact, Chief Daniele and I worked very closely on it. And it was through his efforts that we were able to come up with the concept, and it was great teamwork between the police and the fire. What'll happen is any calls will come in to the police station, including the 911 calls. We will have a state-of-the-art dispatch area, which will include computers, computer-aided dispatch. It really will do nothing but make what already was a good system even better.
And this benefits the residents, right? The residents benefit from this.
Absolutely. There will be less confusion as to how the calls. There will be no diverting of calls, whether it be the fire or a problem, especially when E91 is part of it. There will be monitors. There will be monitors where the call will originate, will show on a monitor instantaneously, practically. It'll give us the name and address of where the call originated from. It'll clear up a lot of some of the problems we have of duplicate streets that sound alike sometimes when people are calling under stress. We may very well have to send two cruisers to two different locations and two ambulances, and that's usually when this happens, is those times of stress when people aren't really calm giving us the information. So we think it'll again do nothing but enhance what we already have, which is good, and it'll make it even better.
And how does that work too? It picks up where the phone call's coming from the actual phone?
the electronics part of it, John, I'm not so sure, Rob. I'm getting quite an education on a lot of that stuff. But the way to simplify it, I guess, in layman's terms, it goes through relays, and in a matter of milliseconds, it comes up on our monitors in the dispatch area. And like I said before, it'll go from the E911 monitors up to our new monitors, which is part of our combined dispatch system, the computer system, the computer-aided dispatch, and it should be fantastic. I'm looking forward.
So much more efficient use of your efforts.
Absolutely.
Great.
Absolutely.
We noticed that the 1993 crime statistics have just been released, and though we saw a 6% increase over the previous year, looking at the past 20 years, 1993 was one of the third lowest in illegal activities. And what do you attribute to this overall drop in crime?
Well, I think there's a lot of things. We like to think it's because of our efforts out there on the street, which I'm sure have been, that contribute to it.
Sure.
There are a lot more devices people use on vehicles for alarms. There's a lot more sophisticated alarm systems that they use in the houses that discourage burglaries. I think that the 6% increase if you take it over, which you mentioned, Jennifer, over the last few years, last year there was an 18% decline.
Mm.
The burglaries, which for a residential area like Newton are quite significant, there was just a marginal increase in those. Some of the increases were in assaults and aggravated assaults, which may be a reflection of our domestic violence and the emphasis that is put on restraining orders and how they handle the changes in the law,
sure,
which allow you to make arrests now where before you couldn't make arrests. So there are contributing factors that raise some of it up, but overall, I think it was a good reflection on the city and on the police department.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned some of the categories that saw a gain: larceny, assaults, and car theft. Are you doing anything in particular to combat these certain areas, or continuing with what you're already doing?
Well, you know, what we're doing is good, but this doesn't mean we're sitting on our laurels.
Sure.
One of the things we are trying to do is to get more visibility out in the street. Right now, in law enforcement throughout the country, is, you know, catchwords such as community policing and those phrases. And in fact, it's always been part of the Newton police philosophy. In my 28 plus years here, we've had people walking squares where it became fashionable in other departments and other parts of the country to take them out of the squares and put them in cruisers. We never did.
Mm-hmm.
We have been limited somewhat by manpower as to how often we put them out there, but one of my goals is to have them out there in a lot more frequency than what they have been in the past, to again show the citizens what the clip that was the introduction there with Officer Geegan. He's a great example of what community policing is in a square. He knows everybody in a square, and that's what community policing is all about.
And are you looking for more men or women to join? I mean, are you going to be hiring more in the future?
Well, we have hired in the last year 15 additional officers, which it's not additional, it's to keep us up. We had a freeze there. We've dropped down in numbers. When we have dropped down in numbers, I think a lot of it, we've made up a lot of the numbers that have been dropped down through technology, in which this combined dispatch and the computer-aided dispatch is just one thing that's going to allow us to a little more flexibility with our sworn personnel. We have a grants. We're always applying for grants. We have an application in now for under the president's bill, which this morning's paper, there was an indication that it was going to be pushed through through Washington.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a grant there, and we're hoping that we can get help.
Chief, I believe you developed a video team, and we have a tape of that video team that you'll be working with.
All my life, and it was a hurting thing. I didn't have anybody to listen to me. I didn't have anybody in my corner. I didn't have nobody there for me. I was all by myself. And when a child has to go, you know, as you were as a child, and a child has to go through what you went through, you should quickly pick that child up. And if it's just on a spur of the moment, if you ain't got nowhere else to go, just go to a shelter, take your child, and flee.
So we have a new video team.
Yeah.
For you, is it for domestic violence?
We're in the process now of they're going to be showing it, I believe, in the next week or so. We have we've completed one other project that was on the rabies, that was aired on the cable access. We have a group of guys that got interested in it. We put out feelers as to who was interested in getting involved in this type of thing. Good enough here at cable access to train us to let us use a lot of their equipment, their editing equipment, and everything else. And these fellows that are involved in it are without a doubt very enthusiastic over it. They do a great job. They got an award for the rabies piece they put together, and this domestic violence piece that they're doing is even better than the other one, from what I've been told.
Our guest has been Chief Gorgone from the Newton Police Department. Frank Gorgone joining us today on NewTV 13, Newton News. And Chief, I know there are a lot of other things we could have gotten into today, but we don't have the time, and we appreciate you stopping by. Maybe that's an invitation for next time. Come on back.
Anytime, John.
All right, thank you very much. We'll be back in just a moment. Stay with us.
Watching the very best in local television programming on NewTV, Channel 13 in Newton. From live gavel-to-gavel coverage of your Board of Aldermen and school committee meetings to news and entertainment programs produced by your neighbors and friends, NewTV 13 is community access television for the people of Newton. To find out more about our programming and how you can make your own TV show, call the Newton Cable Access Corporation Monday through Friday from noon to 6 at 965-7200.
Hi, we're back, and good evening, and welcome to Newton News. And I'm John Frassica, along with Jennifer Knight. And this is a first for us.
So yes, it is.
I think we're doing a pretty good job.
I think we're doing a great job.
I think they'll keep us. I haven't been able to move for the past hour, but I'm doing okay, though. Doing a wonderful job. We have a lot of things going on, and of course, we're going to be here every second and fourth?
That's right, every second and fourth Monday of the month.
Okay,
so we're here again February 14th.
February 14th, so we hope you'll be here on Valentine's night. Should be fun. And let's check now a tape for New Year's open house. Let's see what that was all about.
Mayor Ted Mann began the political new year by throwing open the doors of City Hall for the annual Children's New Year's open house, sponsored by the city's Parks and Recreation Department. Local talent from Paulette's Dance Studio began the day. Folk singer Red Grammer has everyone moving.
And I thought maybe we did this one off of my new tape. I'm going to take a sing-along song. And my family's favorite song is, of course, I bet some of you might
know. Gary the Silent Clown had everyone in not-so-silent stitches.
Well, that looked like it was a lot of fun, didn't it, John?
The silent clown looked excellent. I thought that was fun. Looks like fun.
Well, Mayor Mann was elected once again to 22 more years. His 22nd year, and we have inaugural highlights.
Pomp and circumstance were the order of the day while the city began its new political year, swearing in a new board of aldermen and school committee. Festivities and oaths of office hid deep divisions in the leaderless Board of Aldermen. Mayor Mann kicked off the political new year.
Once again, my heart is beating fast. My emotions surge to the surface as I look out here and once again greet you as the next mayor of the city of Newton.
New TV reporter Marge Heiser was at Mayor Mann's January 22nd inaugural ball to put her finger on the pulse of Mayor Mann's next term office.
What's your greatest wish for the next 4 years?
Peace in the world, happiness, prosperity. We should all be together in good times.
The culmination of a month-long festivities was the Wildwood Quintet inaugural concert held January 23rd at Newton Free Library.
We had some great times, actually. It was a fun time the other night at the inaugural ball. Had a chance to go over there myself.
You were there.
Dressed in a tux.
I wish I could have seen that.
Not often you get to see that.
I get to see that, nor will I ever see it again.
And that's for sure. We have some calendar events, some community calendar events for you. So stay with us, and here they are coming up on your screen. I Promised I Would Tell. Author Sonia Schreiber-Weitz will speak on her poetic memoir of the Holocaust on Thursday, February 10th at 7:30. That's at the Drucker Auditorium, the Newton Free Library. Book signing to follow, and the telephone number for more information, 552-7145. Three women poets read at the Newton Free Library. And that's, again, at the Drucker Auditorium. There they are there. Tuesday, February 8th at 7 o'clock in the evening. February school vacation. Oh, you're going to love this. The Bennington Marionettes, the Bennington Puppets are performing Cinderella. Tuesday, February 22nd, that's at 1 o'clock. It's going to be at the Newton North High School. And you can call for tickets, 552-7130. Friday, February 4th at 12:30 in the afternoon, Boston Symphony Orchestra, Seiji Ozawa, conductor, and John Browning, pianist. Call for tickets, 552-7130.
Wednesday, January 26th, The Importance of Being Earnest at the Huntington Theater. Call 552-7130 for information and tickets. So those were our community calendars. Up next, we've got a police blotter that was arranged by the Newton Police Department for us.
From Friday, January 14th to Thursday, January 20th, the police responded to 711 calls for service. The two most serious were two armed robberies. The owner of the CNN Clean is located at 326 Washington Street, Newton Corner, was robbed at gunpoint. He was placed on the floor and bound with plastic ties. A large amount of money was taken from the safe. The suspects are described as a white male, 28 to 30, 6'1", 200 pounds, dark, mid-collar length hair, mustache, wearing an olive green or brown jacket, and who produced a small dark-colored semi-automatic handgun. Suspect two is a white male, 25 to 28 years old, 6'2", 200 pounds, blonde curly hair, medium length hair, and was wearing a faded orange down winter jacket and faded blue jeans. Both men were wearing construction type work boots. The second armed robbery, which was by knife, occurred on Wednesday the 19th at 4:25 p.m. at the Countryside Pharmacy, which is located at 98 Winchester Street in Newton. A white male entered the pharmacy, produced a knife, and stole a quantity of drugs. He fled the scene in a blue van in the direction of Center Street towards Route 9. The suspect was brought to the pharmacy and was positively identified by the owner. Also during this period, two homes were broken into. The police also responded to four domestic violence incidents.
We're back again on Newton News, and we welcome you. We have on the agenda, it's our municipal meeting agendas, and let's go through them. The Board of Aldermen on the agenda for January 24th, reconvening as a committee of the whole after recessing on January 18th, 1994, without a president, of course. They will vote on a president, vote on a vice president, and chamber seat assignments.
And today also, this special session will be shown live at 7:45 and replayed on tomorrow, the 25th, at 11 p.m., also replayed Wednesday on the 26th at 11 and 10 p.m. Next meeting, Monday, February 7th. That's all the time we do have now. Thank you so much for joining us at Newton News. Tune in to John Frassica every weekday from 11 to 12 on WNTN. That's 1550 a.m. And thanks for joining us. Good night.
Good night.